So, the Carnegie Foundation has come up with this term, practical measures, to refer to the kinds of measures they recommend for continuous improvement. And these are measures that should be embedded in the regular work of practitioners in the process of teaching or learning. Now, it should not pull them away from their work or take them too much time. They should be captured frequently so that the data can inform changes on a continuous basis. Now, you don't want to wait until the end of the semester to know what worked and what didn't. You want indicators of how a change is working all along, so that way you can make revisions, changes, and tweaks as you go. And these measures should be accessible to practitioners who will administer them and who will use the results to make decisions. So a few suggestions here is to implementing practical measures is to plan data collection to align with the daily reality of practitioners, to collect data that is relevant and useful to the practitioners, and then consider if the relevant data is already being collected. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to use the health example, again, that Karen talked about before, to think about how a driver diagram can be useful in generating appropriate measures, both related to the outcomes of interest, which is identified here in the aim statement, and then related to the processes, which is identified in the drivers and change ideas. So remember that the aim here is to lose 15 pounds in 3 months. So, it's fairly obvious that a measure of the patient's weight is the outcome measure of interest. But is that enough? How will she know that she's developed a plan that is sustainable and will allow her to take the weight off and live a healthier lifestyle? And so that's where the process measure comes in. So, I want to take a little pause here just to talk about what process measures are. And so process measures, they are sensitive to the processes, tools, and strategies being tried and pick up on little changes as they're implemented. They are able to predict the likelihood of achieving the aim. So in other words, they provide information that teams can use to determine if they're on the right track. If not, then changes can be made along the way, even small changes, and then checked. Finally, they provide information about how and why changes in the outcome may or may not be occurring. So what we're going to do now is we're going to take a look at the health example again. So here we've identified, obviously, that the weight is the outcome. So what can she do to lose weight? So one thing that she can do is she can increase her exercise regimen. And so therefore, you know, what would be some good process measures that she can utilize to track this? And she can, you know, keep her exercise log, and then also have a Fitbit so that she can track her progress. So let's take a look at the next primary driver, which is increasing her awareness of daily exercise and food. So what can she do to make sure that this is happening? What would be some good process measures? So in this one, she can actually keep a food diary and track her caloric intake so that way she can keep track of what and how much she is eating and making sure that she's making those healthy choices. So here are some examples of the types of process measures we might use in education: daily tracking data, classroom observation data, or teacher and student logs all provide information about what's happening in the classroom, who is participating, how often, when, and how. It can also be helpful to track counts of students related to specific activities, especially if you're looking at engagement. And finally, simple and quick assessments such as do-nows or entry and exit tickets will provide quick information, but that may provide a wealth of data about how changes are playing out. Now, you're going to hear a little bit from our next practitioner on the kinds of data they collect for different process measures.